Well, it's been a great experience this morning, meeting the mayor of Shanghai. You may know that later we'll be breaking ground for a great institute in the science city that's being built. And it's also inspiring to see such a full audience and a crowd on a weekday morning to attend a lecture about science and art. So Shanghai is a great city that's becoming greater, and I intend to help it live up to its potential and the world's potential in developing our opportunities in physics and science.
谢谢各位。 今天早上我的有了一个非常精彩的体验，刚刚呢，我也是见了上海市的市长，稍后呢，我会参加在科学城将要举行的一个研究中心的破土动工的仪式。今天是周日，也是一个工作日，很高兴一大早可以看到大家聚集在这里来聆听这一场关于科学和艺术的讲座。上海是一座了不起的城市，而且它正在变得越来越了不起。
Science is more than strange discoveries and interesting gadgets, however. Science is really a human activity that should enrich all of life and has close relations to in particular, art.
科学其实不仅仅是关于一系列奇妙的发现，以及一系列新的电子或者数码设备的创造和发明。其实，科学应该是一项出现在人类生活方方面面的这样一些活动。它与艺术更加有着非常紧密的联系。And
many great scientists have felt this, as you'll see. And I think it's very, very important to strengthen that relationship because each can benefit from the other.
有很多的科学家都认识到了科学和艺术之间其实有着非常深刻和紧密的联系，并且呢，他们也非常的重视要把这两者之间的联系呢变得更加的紧密。So
in this talk, I will discuss three things. First, the importance of visualization as a human activity and some historical examples of how it's been important in science and how it's important even right now at the frontiers of science.
在今天的这个讲座当中呢，我主要想讲三个问题。第一点呢，就是视觉化的重要性。 其实啊，在人类的生活当中，各项活动当中，视觉化应该是一个非常重要的概念。我会举一些例子，这一些呢，都是在过去历史当中所发生的一些事情，来说明这一个观点。他们呢，对于科学的发展以及对于今天前沿科学的发展呢，仍然有着具有重要的意义。Second,
I'll talk about deep themes that emerge from our most profound understanding of the world and how they turn out remarkably to be also themes that are very central to artistic expression.
我要讲的第二点呢，就是在我们研究和观察我们所生活的这个世纪的过程当中呢，所发现的，和所了解以及认识到的一些非常深刻的这些主题，而且呢，让人惊讶和感到意外的是，这些关于科学、关于自然的一些深刻的主题呢，恰恰呢，也是艺术领域当中的一些深刻的以及永恒的主题。And
then finally, I'll talk about scientific concepts used as metaphors or illustrated by artistic works that somehow bring them to life and bring them into normal human activities and yet convey something of their essence.
那我想讲的最后一个观点呢，就是科学上的一些概念和一些主题呢，是如何以暗喻的 一种隐晦的比喻的方式呢，被呈现在我们所看到的一系列的艺术作品当中，从而呢以一种更加通俗易懂和明显和显明扼要的这样的一种方式呢，能够被人类更多的人和大众的所认识，更多的渗透到人们人类生活的方方面面当中。So
this both humanizes the concepts and also brings out to a scientist unexpected connections and suggestions that can actually be useful in furthering the work and suggesting new directions.
通过以这样一种暗喻的方式呢，把科学概念融入到艺术作品当中呢，一方面也让科学呢变得更加的为普通人所了解、为大众所接受，让它有了更加人性化的一面。而另一方面呢，这种与普通与普罗大众与世界的这种联系，也使得科学家呢从这样的一个过程当中呢，有了更多的一个启发和一个启示。So
without further ado, let me start on the first of these three themes, the theme of visualization.
好，接下来呢，我就来讲我刚刚所说到的第一个问题，也就是视觉化。
I will argue that visualization is very profound because it's a way in which we learn to talk with ourselves and communicate with different parts of our being.
我想说的一个观点就是视觉化呢，它其实是一个非常深刻和一个深奥的一个话题，它涉及到我们一个人生活的以及感知世界的方方面面，对我们生活的方方面面其实都有着非常深入的影响。If
you look at a brain, look at a human brain, which is, of course, the organ of thought, it doesn't look very structured. It looks like a big pool of jelly.
如果我们来看一看我们人类的大脑，也就是我们思考的器官，我们会发现啊，它其实并不是一个非常有序的或者说组织精密的一个结构，它看起来呢更像是一块像果冻一样的这么一个物体。But
in fact, it is very structured. Different parts of the brain think about different things, do different tasks, and in real sense speak different languages.
但事实上啊，我们的大脑却是一个构造十分精良的这样的一个器官。大脑的不同的位置、不同的部分呢，会思考不同的物、思考不同的问题，开展一些不同的活动，甚至呢，在很多特定的情况下呢，会运用并且呢来讲不同的语言。A
very large part of our brain, depending on how you count, between 20% and 50% is devoted to processing visual information.
其实我们的大脑有很大一部分，可以说是有20%到50%的这样的一个比例呢，是用来处理有关视觉的信息的。So
that each of us, each normally developed human being, can do the remarkable feat of changing two-dimensional images, two-dimensional signals that arrive at the back of our eye into a conceptual world in three dimensions with objects moving around in different places with different with an accurate rendering of their geometrical relationships.
我们每一个发展正常的人呢，都可以做到非常了不起的一点，那就是啊，我们的眼球可以接收到二D的，也就是二维的这个视觉的信息，并且呢，通过我们大脑处理之后呢，可以把它转化为带有空间维度的三维的这样的一个视觉的信号，里面呢包含了各个物体在我们眼前在这个空间当中的位置，它们的运动以及它们精确的一个在这个整个几何空间当中的一个定位。
Even if we haven't had classes in geometry or forgotten what we learned in them or never really learned anything in them or if we've never heard of what projective geometry is, we can do these things really fast and really well.
就算我们从来没有学过或者接触过几何学，但是我们的大脑或者说我们人呢，确实可以毫不费力的、快速的并且精确的做到这一点。
But we don't know how and we haven't been able to teach computers how to do it very well, because we don't know how.
但是啊，我们却并不知道我们自己呢，我们人是怎么样做到这一点的。也正是因为我们不知道是怎么做到的，所以呢，我们也没有办法把这个这整个的过程呢来精确的交给别人，也不可能把它来交给电脑，让电脑呢来做到这一切。
So these parts of the brain use a language of their own, a language that which the reasoning and logical parts of our brain don't really have access to and don't really understand directly.
所以说这可以说是我们大脑它自己所自带的一种语言系统。这样的一个语言系统或者说大脑的这样的一个功能啊，是我们大脑另外的具有推理具有逻辑思考的这些功能的区域呢它所没有办法理解的。
So wouldn't it be wonderful if we could teach the parts of our brain that reason consciously and talk how to access these very, very powerful parts of the brain that speak in purely visual languages?
所以说啊，如果说我们能够找到一种方法，让我们逻辑思维的，也就是说，有意识的那一部分的大脑呢，能够来理解，来学会，就是我们大脑的这个处理视觉信息这一部分的功能是怎么样开展的，它是怎样的一个过程？如果我们能够把这个过程掌握的话，将会是一件非常了不起的事情。
So that's what visualization is all about. Teaching us to communicate with ourselves, with different parts of ourselves, so that different parts of our brains can share their strengths.
那么这一个过程，也就是我们所要学习的，但是现在还不了解的这样的一个大脑运作的过程呢，就是视觉化的过程。如果说我们能够让我们自己身体的各个部分，或者说我们自己呢，能够有意识的来了解这是一个怎么样的过程，并且呢，能够把它清楚的掌握下来的话呢，这将会是具有非常深远的、深刻的意义的。
So let me show you now an example of perhaps the greatest visualization of all time, which illustrates these principles very well.
接下来我就来给大家举一个例子，这个呢可以说是我们所知道的视觉化的最为典型的一个例子。从这个例子当中，我们可以非常清楚的来了解视觉化究竟是怎样的一个过程。
Oh, sorry, I'm pushing this the wrong way. Sorry, I pushed the buttons the wrong way. Okay, so. This kind of visualization is due to the French philosopher mathematician René Descartes and was invented in the late 17th century.
这个呢是法国的数学家以及哲学家 René Descartes 在17世纪所做的一个关于视觉化的一个实验。
And what Descartes taught us to do is translate from the language of symbols and algebra into the language of shapes that our eyes, so this is a kind of logical language, this is a visual language that convey, that are about the same thing, that are different representations of the same thing, and allow us to think about them in two very different powerful ways.
在笛卡尔他所做的这个试验当中啊，他把一些代数的符号，也就是我们在横轴上看到的这些 x、y 这一个非常逻辑的这样一个代数的方程式里面包含的这些代数符号呢，转化成为一些图形，也就是视觉化的一些符号。通过这些视觉化的图形和符号这样的一个语言呢，来表达这个代数方程式它的意义。可以说呢，是用两套完全不同的语言系统呢，来表达一个同。
So let me quickly, very quickly describe exactly what this is. Perhaps some of you have seen this in school, but if you, if this is an equation between two quantities, x and y, that depends on two other quantities, a and b. And if you plot the magnitude of x in this direction, the magnitude of y in that direction, for different values of A and B, the values of X and Y for which this is satisfied, that is, this particular combination of X's and Y's equals zero, makes a curve. And the curves have different shapes.
我来给大家简单的解释一下，我们可以看到这是一个代数方程式，里面包含了两对不同的变量，一对是 x y， 一对呢是 a 和 b。那么我们可以看到每一个小方块啊，如果说它的水平轴都是表示 x， 而竖轴呢是表示 y 的话，我们可以看到在a 和 b， 也就是整个的这个大的这个图形当中，当 a 和 b 是不同的数值的时候啊，我们可以看到 x y 的它的变量呢。 被笛卡尔通过一系列不同的波浪的曲线，这些不同的图形呢来表示了出来，也就是说，以不对针对不同的 A 和 B 呢 ，x、y 有不同的数值，而这样的一个数量的一个变化关系呢，是可以通过图形，也就是视觉化的这样的一套符号的系统来表示的。
But if you don't follow the details of all that, that's all right, because the big message is very simple. The big message is that whereas this logical representation has all the information about the mathematics in a very precise form, it kind of just sits there on the page and is very hard to think about abstractly.
可能大家并不了解这个详细的信息和内容，但是这个没关系。笛卡尔所要表达的一个主要的观点呢，就是啊，我们看这个下面这个代数方程，我们知道在这一系列的变量，也就是 x、y、a、b 之间，它们有着一个互相制约或者说互相联系的这样的一个关系。但是这样的一种关系呢，是没有办法通过这样的一个方程式来进行一个抽象的这样的一种理解的。
And in particular,the visual parts of our brain, which are so powerful and can do such wonderful tricks in geometry, can't do anything with that representation.
但是啊，我通过视觉化的表述，也就是我们把它转化成为一些视觉的符号和图形之后啊，我们看到它的作用，它的效果就不一样了。
But if you represent the same thing in pictures, all kinds of patterns and questions emerge.
它可以说呢，是通过视觉化，通过图形的表达呢，我们可以通过这些图形来非常直观的了解到这个代数方程式，原先所包含的这些逻辑的和这些数理的这些意义。
You see, sometimes the curves fall into pieces. They have disconnected parts. Sometimes they cross each other. Sometimes they wiggle a lot. Sometimes they wiggle just a little. If you ask,When does that happen, and how does one evolve into another? You're led into kinds of questions and kind of investigations that are extremely fruitful that you would never have been led into just by staring at the bottom line.
通过这些图形，我们可以看到，有的时候它是一条曲线，这些曲线呢又有不同的弯曲度和形状，而有的时候呢又会出现一些不相互不连接的一些圆点，还有的时候呢这些圆圈和曲线呢是互相交叉的，所以说呢它会有不同的情况，千变万化，变化无穷。但是所有这一些变化呢，如果你单单只是看那个代数的方程式，你是根本没有办法想象出来，也是没有办法去体会的。
And this has become one of the most vibrant areas of mathematics, even today, algebraic geometry.
而这一个研究的领域呢，可以说，多年以来一直到现在呢，仍然是在数学科学当中非常活跃的这样的一个研究领域，也就是呢，代数几何学。
Now let me switch to one of the greatest episodes in physics, which was also an adventure in visualization. This was the crowning the most important achievement, I would say, of physics in the 19th century.
好，接下来我们再转过头来看一看物理学。我们来看看在物理学当中视觉化所带来的一次巨大的发现。在我本人看来，我觉得这可以说是19世纪物理学研究当中最为重要的一项内容。
And it came about by way of a collaboration between two men who hardly knew each other, although both of them worked in England. Michael Faraday, an experimentalist who worked in the early part of the 19th century, and James Clerk Maxwell, a theorist actually from Scotland, who flourished in the middle and later parts of the 19th century.
这一个研究呢，是在两位互相完全不认识的物理学家之间的合作开展起来的。一位呢是法拉第，他呢是19世纪初期英格兰著名的实验物理学家；另一位呢是 James Maxwell， 他呢是苏格兰人，他是19世纪中后期的一位非常知名的理论物理学家。
And in many ways, they were like different parts of the brain. Faraday was the visual part, and Maxwell was the analytical part.
其实呢，他们两人做的事情呢很有意思。我们可以把他们想象成我们大脑的两个不同的部分。他们所做的事情啊，法拉第他所做的就是那个视觉化的直观的这一部分，而麦克斯韦尔呢，他就是分析的、推理的、逻辑思考的这一部分。
Maxwell took Faraday's pictures and turned them into equations, and then back into pictures.
麦克斯韦尔他所做的事情啊，就是把法拉利所画的那些图形啊，换算成转变成方程式，然后呢又把它转化成图形。
And today, the gift they gave us today is still how we understand electricity and magnetism, and the basis of all modern communication technologies. Your iPhone wouldn't begin to work, and the internet wouldn't begin to work without it.
这两位物理学家留给我们今天后人的礼物啊，也就是关于电磁场的理论啊，直到今天仍然是很多重大的科学技术发明的基础，它是奠定了我们人类在二十一世纪互相沟通的这些所有的电信系统的一个基础，包括我们今天用到的手机，我们所用的互联网都离不开这两位科学家的发现。
It actually began in a very peculiar way, really because.In a real sense, because Michael Faraday was disadvantaged.
其实这项研究的开始是非常特别的。其实从很大程度上来说，他的之所以可以得到一个发现，是因为法拉第当时啊，他处在一个非常不利的位置。
He came from a very poor family and didn't receive a conventional strong education.
法拉第他家里面很穷，也没有受过非常正统的正规的教育。
But he was an apprentice to a bookbinder and read the books.
但是啊，当时啊，他在一家书店里面打工，所以呢，他有机会读了很多的书。
And he became very interested in the science books and copied the experiments and tried to understand what they were about.
法拉第啊，他对科学的一些书籍啊，产生了浓厚的兴趣。他经常呢，自己会偷偷的模仿里面所讲到的一些科学的实验。
But he never learned mathematics properly, so he treated everything he was learning in kind of visual or linguistic terms, not mathematics.
但是啊，因为法拉第他本人呢，没有接受过正规的或者说系统的数学的一个学习，所以说对于他所发现的和看到的一切啊，他都习惯用一种图形的一种直观的，也就是我们所说的一种视觉化的方式呢，来进行呈现和归纳，而没有用到任何的数学或者说是逻辑推理的一些方式。
So he thought very, very differently from everyone else, from the more educated, more learned. Scientists who had done a lot of equations about electricity and magnetism.
So, from this 角度上来说啊，法拉第所做的工作呢，他跟很多其他进行过一些系统正规教育的一些物理学家、数学家所做的工作呢，是完全不一样的。他所遵循的是一套完全不一样的方法，在这个方法当中呢，并没有什么方程式、什么数学逻辑推理的这一系列的工具，而是完全直观的一套视觉化的工具。
And this is what Maxwell had to say about him.Faraday, in his mind's eye, saw lines of force traversing all space, where the mathematicians saw centers of force attracting at a distance. Faraday saw a medium where they saw nothing but distance.
Maxwell 呢，他是这么来形容法拉第和他所做的工作的。他说啊，在法拉第的头脑里，在他的脑海里面，他所看到的呢，是在这个空间当中布满了相互作用力的这些线条，而这些线条呢，在数学家眼里看来呢，只不过是一些相互之间隔了一定的距离，并且相互吸引的这种力的一个中心点。而法拉第能够看到的呢，是一个场，是一种介质，而其他人呢，看到的就仅仅只有距离，除此之外呢，什么都没有。
So.Here's one of Faraday's famous illustrations, and maybe you've seen something like this as a toy, where you sprinkle iron filings over a magnet, and they form this pattern. These are Faraday's lines of force. You see, instead of thinking about the forces that one magnet exerts on each other, on another one through empty space, Faraday visualized.A magnetic influence that filled all space and sort of had a line of life of its own that was based on these kinds of phenomena that he turned into pictures so he could think about what magnetism and electricity meant in visual terms.
这个就是法拉利非常著名的一张绘图。在这个图当中呢，法拉利把他所观察到的现象呢，用图形的方式呢表达了出来。在他看来啊，在这个空间当中是充满了作用力线，这些线条呢，布满了整个的空间。而在当时其他的一些数学家看来啊，其实只是这个空间当中存在的呢，只是两个互相之间隔着一定距离的两个作用力的点。但是在法拉利看来呢，其实在整个空间当中都是布满了这样的一些作用力的。他看起来呢，在他眼中这是一个场的这样一个概念。所以说这个图可能在我们看来都很熟悉，大家可能看到过一些玩具啊，或者说我们小时候玩磁铁的时候呢，如果你把这个铁钉放在一起，可能就是能够看到这样的一个图形。但是法拉利啊，他通过自己的想象，通过自己的实验，在他的脑海当中就视觉化的出现了这样的一个图形。
This idea of fields filling all space as the primary ingredients of reality was quite revolutionary at the time. Since then, it's come to dominate our deep understanding of physics.
法拉利对于电磁场的这样的一种发现，他所提出的这样的一个场的概念，这样的一种就是说场是存在于整个空间当中的这样的一个概念呢，在当时看来是具有颠覆性的，是当时的人们所不能想象的，但是它却是今天很多物理学研究的一个基础。
So although many mathematicians who were more learned at the time didn't take Faraday's idea seriouslyBecause they weren't expressed mathematically, Maxwell did, and he tried to turn them into mathematics and deal with both the visual and the logical parts at the same time.
法拉利的这种发现呢，在当时很多其他的科学家、数学家，或者说那些受过正统教育的数学家的人眼中呢，他们觉得这个不算什么，不把它当一回事儿。但是麦克斯韦尔呢，他却不这么想。他呢，企图用数学的逻辑的方法呢，来把法拉利的这种发现啊，能够把它用一个更加严谨的数学的语言呢，来表达出来。
And this was fantastically successful. Maxwell, using the idea of fields, formulated equations which can be stated pictorially, and here they are, the so-called Maxwell's equations, which to this day are the foundation of our best understanding and very accurate understanding of electricity and magnetism.
而且麦斯威尔他做得非常的成功，他成功的呢把法拉第所发现的关于电磁场的这样的一个直观的一个概念的转换成了数学的方程式，也就是他所写的著名的麦斯威尔方程式。麦斯威尔方程式在今天仍然是有关电磁场的物理学所有的这个理论以及实验的这个发现的一个基础。
In view of the time and the hot weather in here.I will not explain this in detail, but it's beautifully explained in my book.
时间关系，而且呢，我们天气又这么热，我在这儿呢就不详细给大家介绍这个方程式代表的意思是什么了。但是在我的书当中呢，大家可以找到更加详细的一个解答。
So you can read about it there.
所以大家可以回去读一读我写的书。
Now today, we face no less opportunities and challenges in visualization.And they are important questions at the frontier of science, where art also plays a role. For instance, specifically, we understand that in quantum theory, which is our accurate description of molecules, electrons shouldn't be thought of as simple points, but as clouds of probabilities for where the electrons can be found at different times.
其实在今天的科学研究当中啊，视觉化它所带给我们的机遇以及它所面临的挑战呢，并不比那个时代来得更少。在今天的前沿科学的研究当中啊，其实艺术仍然扮演着非常重要的作用。举个例子来说啊，我们在量子理论当中，我们知道量子理论呢，其实它就是对于分子的一个更加精确的一个研究的这样的一门学科。在量子理论当中，我们看到的电子，它其实并不是一个简单的一个点，一个确定的位置的一个点， 它更多的呢是以一个概率的形式存在的，或者说也就是我们所说的电子云，就是说我们所能够描述的呢并不是电子它所存在的一个精确的位置，它更多的是告诉我们说它有多少的几率可以出现在某一个地方。
And calculating the shapes of these clouds is a difficult problem in quantum mechanics, but it's very important because if you want to know how the molecules react, how they combine to make other useful molecules or how theyinteract with each other to do useful things, you have to know what the electrons, how the electrons match up and influence each other. So you have to have a good picture of where they are.
在今天啊，我们仍然没有办法能够很好的来描述我们所说的这些电子云，它究竟是一个怎样的形状，是以怎样的形式存在的。但是在量子力学上来说呢，你要能够去研究电子之间是如何相互作用，或者说分子之间是如何来相互作用，相互的引起一些反应，来研究很多与分子相关的这些问题的话呢，你必须要能够知道电子云究竟是怎样的一个形状。那么在这个过程当中，很多时候我们都需要有一个视觉化的这样的一种研究的方式。
Now, if you're just given computer output that tells you numerically what the solutions of the equations look like, it's very difficult to use that. It's very difficult for our brains to use that information. But if you make pictures of it, you get a good idea of what the molecule looks like to an electron and how different molecules will fit together or not and how they will react to do things that are useful.That you want done.
就比方说啊，如果说这个电子之间的相互作用，我们仅仅用数学方程式的方法来表达呢，你当你只是看着那些方程式，你是很难，你的大脑是没有办法来处理那些信息的。对于你的大脑来说呢，这些方程式并没有什么帮助，也没有什么作用来帮助你理解。但是说，如果你能够用一些图像的方式，用一个视觉化的方式来呈现这些数学的概念的话呢，你就能够，你的大脑就能够更好的来处理这些信息，能够更加直观的来理解电子之间或者说分子之间是如何来相互作用的。
So these are not just pretty pictures, but also contain useful information. And I think if artists would help us to make even prettier pictures, we would get even more information out of them.And be able to do even more wonderful things.
这些图片啊，我们所看到的这些图像，电子云的图像，不仅仅是看起来很漂亮。对于科学家来说，它可以帮助我们来思考，来理解很多问题。而且我相信，如果说艺术家能够帮助我们把它做得更加的漂亮，更加的直观和生动的话呢，它能够更好的来帮助科学的研究。
Now I will very quickly describe, show you one more picture. This is a picture of empty space.This has more to do with my own work. We learn in advanced quantum theory that what we see as empty space is not at all empty. It's full of activity that are called quantum fluctuations or virtual particles. If our eyes could see much smaller times and how things change over much smaller times than they can and much smaller distances than they can resolve, we would see this kind of, this is what space would look like to us.We'd see constantly a kind of weather where energy concentrates and dissipates and flows from one place to another. So here is a snapshot of the weather, and here is kind of a movie of the weather in empty space.
接下来给大家看的呢，这个是我自己所做的一项研究。其实在我们眼前所看到的呢，是一个空白的空间。但是根据深度的量子理论来说啊，我们所看到的一些空白的空间其实根本不是空白的，这个里面呢是充满了各种各样的活动。而这些活动呢，是由我们所说的一些虚拟的粒子所带来的。这些粒子呢，相互之间不断的作用，不断的活动，它所产生的呢，其实是有各种各样的一个空间。所以说，如果能够把这些活动捕捉下来的话呢，我们眼前就会出现一个完全不一样的画面。
And particles like quarks that have to move through this weather have their properties drastically changed by this kind of atmosphere that exists in empty space. And it's understanding things like that that got me the Nobel Prize.
其实啊，就是说我们眼前所看到的这个有不断的能量在涌动的这样的一个空间啊，其实就是我们所谓的一个空白的空间。在量子理论当中啊，夸克这样的最微小的粒子的必须要通过这样一个能量场，而在这个过程当中的夸克的性质 会得到改变，会产生一些完全不同的一些作用。这个关于这一个能量场和夸克粒子之间的相互作用呢，这个就是这方面的研究和发现呢，让我得到了2004年的诺贝尔物理学奖。
But these, but I didn't make these pictures. I'm not smart enough. This is a massive computer calculation done by Professor Lineweber at the University of Adelaide in Australia. But it's wonderful to be able to visualize what was originally just in equations.And having these visualizations of the weather in empty space is leading us to understand it better. Oops. Like this.
这个模型啊，大家所刚刚看到的这个模型呢，不是我本人做的，我没有这个本事。它是由澳大利亚阿德雷大学的一位教授所制作的这样的一个电脑的模型，它描述了我们所谓的这个空白的、一无所有的这个空间当中，事实上所发生的这些事情，这样的所有的活动。而这样的一种形象啊，是简单的或者说是枯燥的数学方程式完全没有办法告诉我们的。所以说，通过这样的一种视觉化的、直观的方式啊，我们大脑呢可以更好的来理解很多我们原先没有办法想象的一些科学的以及物理的概念。
So I've shown you some historical examples of very important and powerful visualizations that we still use today, and I've also shown you how visualization is still important at the frontiers of science. Now I'm going to move to my second topic, which is a remarkable.Meeting of the deepest concepts of science and some major themes of art.
刚刚我给大家讲的呢，就是我想要说的第一个问题，就是视觉化。我讲述了它在过去以及现在的科学研究当中是扮演了怎样的一个作用，以及在将来，它在前沿的科学研究当中还是会起到一个非常重要的这样的一个作用。那么接下来我想给大家讲的呢，就是我想说的第二个问题，也就是关于科学以及艺术的一些非常深刻的主题。
Now, if I were asked, what are the deepest messages about how the world works that we've gotten from modern physics?That may not be familiar to most people, and that have led us to very, very powerful understanding. I would say that the most important are two, which are symmetry and exuberance. Symmetry, well, I'll explain in a moment what we mean by that in science. Exuberance, I'll also explain, but is basically the idea that you get a lot out of a little.
如果说啊，有人问我要如何从现代物理学的角度来说一说对于这个世界，我们所生活的这个大自然和世界的最根本的发现和认识是什么的话，我想说最重要的一点，或者说两点呢，就是一个是对称，另外一个呢是繁衍或者说繁盛。对称这个概念呢，稍后我会再从科学的角度来给大家做一些比较深入的一个解释。那么对于繁盛这个概念要怎么来理解呢？我想其实非常简单，它就是说通过我们是如何从一点点从无到有，从少变多这样的一个过程。
So what is symmetry? Well, it's a word, at least in English, I don't know about in Chinese, but it's a word that has kind of a somewhat vague meaning. It means balance, it means harmony, it means attractiveness somehow. To use it in science, however, we need a more precise definition.
那么什么是对称呢？我不知道在中文当中是怎么样，但是在英语当中啊，其实对称 symmetry 这个词的概念呢，它是有一些模糊的。它既代表了平衡，它也可以代表和谐，甚至是一种吸引力。所以说，我们怎么样的从科学的角度来定义什么是对称呢？
And the concept of symmetry that's turned out to be important in science.Sounds mystical or almost paradoxical, but it is literally that symmetry is change without change. Let me explain it in an example.
其实从科学的角度来说，我觉得对称呢可以理解成为是万变不离其宗。让我再来给大家解释一下。
Think about a circle, which we'll all agree is a very symmetrical shape. How does that fit into this definition of change without change? Well, if you take a circle, you can rotate it around its center through any angle. And although every single point on that circle will have moved, so you've made a change, the circle as a whole does not change. That's what makes a circle a very symmetric object, that you can subject it to transformations that might have changed it, but don't.
怎么来理解这个概念呢？我们可以想象一个圆圈，一个圆形，它可以说是一个最为对称的这样的一个图形了。那么我们现在让它来，怎么来解释这个万变不离其宗这样一个对称的概念呢？如果说我们让这个圆圈围绕着一个中心点不停地转动的话呢，其实你如果看这个圆圈上每一个点，单纯看一个点的这个点，可能是它的位置发生了移动，它有一个改变，有一个变化。但是你从整体上来说呢，它仍然是一个圆。
Symmetry is something that humans have found beautiful across many cultures for a long time.
在不同的人类文明当中，我们都可以发现，人们把对称呢当成是一种非常美的，或者说是一个审美的这样一个标准。
And you can especially see this in decorative art, like wallpaper designs or designs that you see in mosaics at the Alhambra, but in also in many, many cultures. Once when I was visiting Paris near the Louvre, I found an atlas that was thousands of pages, literally, of patterns like this, taken from different cultures, showing how they use symmetry in their decorative art.
我们在不同的人类文明当中都可以看到，在装饰艺术当中，像是在一些墙纸啊、马赛克的设计图形当中啊，对称这样的一个概念呢，被反复的运用。这是我有一次在巴黎圣母院附近的一个收藏当中看到的，就是它对于就是在不同的文化当中，人们是怎样的运用对称这样一个图形来做装饰的。我觉得非常有意思，我就把它收集了下来。Ranging
from Vikings to Celtic monks, or of course, also in China and Japan.
这里面啊，有来自维京人，有凯尔特人的一些，包括在他们的这个修道院当中所运用到的这些图形，还有在来自日本、来自中国的一些运用对称的一些设计。
And you can see the sort of change without change. If I move these guys over by two units, they might have changed, but they don't. Or if I move them by one unit and change the colors appropriately, it doesn't change also. So there are different kinds of transformations that might have changed this pattern but don't. That's why we see it as a very symmetric pattern.
所以说我们怎么来看这个对称，就是万变不离其宗这样一个概念呢？就比方说，刚刚的这个小的这个图形，如果我把它向右移动两个位置的话，你可以看到它还是原来那个图形，还是以原先不变的这个图形。如果移动一个位置的话，可能只是改变了一下它的颜色。所以说你会发现在对称的这样的一个图形当中啊，其实从整体上来说，它的变化其实是就是不变的。
And the amazing thing that's happened in physics, especially in the 20th century, but continuing into the 21st century, we hope, is that guessing that nature likes to use equations that are very symmetric, that allow a lot of transformations that don't change their consequences, that those are the equations that nature likes.
从上一世纪到21世纪，而且在将来的研究当中啊，我们都发现。 其实，在自然界来说，大自然是很喜欢来运用一些对称的这样的一些方程式，来演绎它的很多的问题。其实，大自然的很多问题、很多现象，或者说科学研究很多的结论呢，最终都归结到一个对称这样的一个概念。It's
difficult to explain this in detail without getting a bit technical, and I won't do that here. But the concept of symmetry that's proved amazingly powerful in physics is what's called local symmetry, which means you make some kind of change over here and a different kind of change over there and a different kind of change over there, yet overall, the consequences of the equations don't change.
其实要真正能够来解释对称这个概念呢，从科学的角度来说，不免的会变得有一些技术性。那么在这里呢，我只是简单的给大家来做一个比较笼统的一个介绍。我觉得有一个概念非常重要，那就是在物理学当中，我们有一个叫做局部对称的概念。什么叫做局部对称呢？就是说啊，在这个物理学当中，很多时候我们都发现，一个方程式或者说一个现象，它在不同的位置可能是有了一些改变。有一些在不同的位置，在同一时间有一些改变，但是就整体上来说呢，它仍然是对称，仍然是不变的。
So this was a tremendous innovation in physics that was introduced by primarily by Professor Yang, C.N. Yang, and Mills in the 1950s, but developed enormously in subsequent decades. The concept that nature likes equations that have this kind of local symmetry.
这个概念呢是 C.N. Yang 和 Mills 在20世纪50年代的最先提出来的。但是在之后的一系列研究当中啊，这样的一个概念被不断的得到了反复的验证。也就是说，大自然自然界呢是非常喜欢对称的这样的一个方式的。But
in a way, artists had appreciated it long before. Here, especially in the decorative art you find in mosques, where they're trying to express their idea of divinity. You see that they use elements that are symmetric, but to bring out their symmetry, you have to do different things in different places. So if you want to bring out the symmetry of this circle, you have to rotate it around its center. But if you want to bring out the symmetry of this circle, you have to rotate it around its center, and so forth. There are little triangles here that allow you to transform them into each other if you rotate them around their center by 120 degrees and so forth. There's local symmetry galore that's dominating this design.
这是一个清真寺的一个设计，我们可以看到，在它的这个装饰设计当中呢，到处都充斥了这种局部对称的概念。比方说这些圆形，这些圆形你要如果把它当成是一个对称的一个形状的话呢，你必须要从它的中心位置出发来看，那么它才是一个对称的圆形。还有周围的这些小三角，它可能要旋转120度，然后才能够找到它的对称的那个三角。所以说，你可以看到这些设计当中的对称啊，其实都是
So that's one of the great deep concepts that I would say has dominated modern physics. Another that's not so much a matter of discovering the equations, but using them and drawing out their consequences is the principle of exuberance.
所以这个就是我所说的现代物理学的一个最为基本的，或者说一个根本的一个发现，也就是对称。而另一个呢，就是我所说的这个反胜的概念。And
this is the idea, which is a creative idea, but also an observation about how nature works, that by putting a lot of simple things together, you can get something beautifully intricate.
这个呢，既可以说是我们对于自然世界的一种观察，它也可以说呢是一个创造性的一个发现或者说一个概念。什么意思呢？反正就是说，当你把很多简单的事物放在一起的时候呢，常常都会得到一些非常精妙的、复杂的一些设计和结构。And
I will even claim and show you that symmetry powers exuberance.
我还可以给大家来介绍，来展示一下。其实啊，正是对称的这样一个概念呢，推动了反射。So
here is an extremely impressive example of symmetry, where you see that if you change it by change the shape of this thing by magnifying it, it doesn't change.
这个就是我在大自然当中所找到的一个非常经典的一个关于对称和反射之间相互关系的一个例子。比方说，你可以看中间这个小点，你把它不断的放大，跟它周围的相比较，你会发现它其实没有改变，并没有什么变化。The
big parts are just identical copies of the smaller parts.
你把它作为一个整体来看，你会发现这个大的这个形状啊，其实就是这个小形状的不断的重复和一个倍增。
into this beautiful pattern. Now, how did something as stupid as a piece of broccoli learn about these geometrical concepts and how to orchestrate symmetry in such creative ways.
这其实就是一个简单的植物，一个菜花。你可以发现，你仔细看它，你可以看到这种非常简单，但是呢，却又非常精密和复杂的这样的一种结构，就是完全完完全全的体现了它的一个繁盛，同时但其中呢又蕴含了对称的这样一个概念。The
point is that if you want to make beautiful symmetric patterns, sometimes being stupid is a good idea.
再换句话来说啊，其实有的时候，如果你要做出一些非常漂亮、精美的一些设计的时候啊，其实你其实蠢钝一点比较好。其实就是怎么简单就怎么来。If
you only know how to do one thing, which is grow a little bud in this particular shape, and you grow and let it grow, and then do it again, and then do it again, then do it again, you make yourself into this gorgeous broccoli.
你看这个菜花，它看起来非常的漂亮，但是它是怎么长出来的呢？如果你仔细的看一看、想一想的话，其实就是一个小花苞、一个小花蕾，然后就是不断的长啊长，以同样的方式不断的重复、不断的长，慢慢慢慢的你就看到它变成了一个非常复杂又精美的这样一个结构，这样的一个生命体。Similarly,
trees, we admire their beauty.
同样的，我们看这棵树，我们也会觉得它很漂亮的一棵大树。
And I think one of the sources of that is that they have a kind of symmetry, that the small parts are just shrunken versions of the large parts, or vice versa. The large parts reflect the structure of the small parts magnified.
但是在我看来，我觉得其实你仔细看的话，你会发现它的这种美来自于什么地方呢？其实你如果仔细看，就是大树干，分叉成不同的小树干，这些小的树枝、树杈呢，总和在一起又组成一个大的一个树冠，然后就是不断的在这个两者之间的重复一个重叠。So
how did trees get to be such good artists?
所以我们能够看到树啊，是其实大自然的树木，其实它本身也是一位了不起的艺术家。It's
because they know the power of getting a lot out of a little, just doing one trick over and over again.
其实我们会发现，这个大树之所以能够形成为艺术家，其实它所遵循的就是非常简单的一条，就是一个非常简单的一个小事物，或者说一个小枝芽，然后不断的重复，不断的长，不断的繁衍繁殖，不断的重复，按照这个对称的原则来重复，就成为了这样的一棵大树。This
kind of idea is taken perhaps to its extreme in constructing fractals. Here you have a computer do something very, very simple over and over again and represent the results, and you find that the results form these fantastic patterns that most people find quite beautiful and that no human artist ever dreamt of, but computers have helped us to discover them.
这个可以说是一个比较极端的这样一个在对称和繁盛之间达到一个完美的一个结合的这样的一个例子。这是电脑自动生成的这样的一个图形，它的原则非常简单，就是不断的重复、不断的反叠加、不断的重复再生成。而这个呢，却是我们人类或者说我们人艺术家通过自己的艺术创作没有办法达到的这样的一个效果。
And can you imagine trying to draw something like this by hand? Just inventing it out of your mind, but following simple rules over and over again, a computer produces this.
要是我们来想象一下，就是单单靠人，我们用人手来绘制的话，要怎样才能够达到这样的一种效果？但其实用电脑来做，它就非常简单，几乎不需要思考，就是不断的重复，按照一个简单的原则，在不断的重复的生成，就得到了最终的这样一个效果。
This very lively, this very elegant, this very alive object.
我们可以看到它出来的效果呢，是非常生动又非常优美的。
Now, when we also try to design things that are very efficient out of a few building blocks, they it's found to be efficient to organize them into very, very symmetric patterns. What you see here is the inside of a powerful computer. This is the heart of a powerful computer. This is an Intel design. And you see that they make, I think, quite attractive art objects.
有的时候啊，我们要能够发明出一些非常高效的设计的时候呢，其实也只要遵照一个对称的原则就可以了。这个呢是英特尔电脑的一个内核，我不知道大家是怎么看，但是在我看来，它本身就是一个非常漂亮的，或者说一个非常美的这样的一个设计。
So often the way to make things that work beautifully is to make beautiful things.
所以很多时候啊，如果我们要让一个设计出来的一个物件能够运作的好，运作的高效，很多时候只要把它设计成一件美丽的物件就可以了。
Okay, now I've talked, I think, for almost an hour. I would like to leave some time for questions, but let me just show you a few pictures from the third part of my talk, which is about scientific metaphors.
在我讲我第三个观点，也就是科学的暗喻之前呢，因为我想我已经讲了差不多有一个小时，所以我想听一听大家，有什么问题，大家可以在我讲第三个问题之前提出来。
So bridges from deep reality to everyday reality.
这是我要讲的第三个观点，就是在深刻的现实和日常的现实之间的桥梁。
The most of these pictures were results of a collaboration with my wife that I've done, and with help from museum people to celebrate Richard Feynman's 100th birthday. And there's a website that contains more examples and more discussion of these examples, there it is.
这是我和我的太太和一些博物馆的同事一起做的一个项目，它是为了纪念理查德·费曼，也是一位知名的物理学家诞辰100周年所做的一个项目。这个网站上大家可以找到更多关于与之相关的内容和一些讨论。
There will be an exhibit based on this at the Singapore Art Science Museum opening in October.
今年十月份呢，在新加坡艺术与科学博物馆呢，会关于这个项目呢有一个专门的展览。
So Richard Feynman was a very famous physicist.
理查德·费曼是一位非常知名的物理学家。
Some of you may have heard of him.
我相信在座可能有人听到过他的名字。
He won a Nobel Prize, and that's sort of the least of it. He gave many important ideas to physics, but he was also an artist. And here you see a page of his doodlings, sort of reminiscent of notebooks of Leonardo da Vinci, where you see figures mixed up with calculations and graphs, and obviously the visual part of his brain and the more abstract reasoning parts of his brains were working at the same time.
费曼是一位非常知名的物理学家，他曾经得到过诺贝尔物理奖，但在我看来，这是他最少小的一个成就。他对于物理学以及数学都有着非常杰出的贡献，但是同时他又是一位艺术家。我刚刚给大家看的就是他的一个手记，在上面我们既看到一些数学的方程式，也看到他所绘的描绘的一些人体啊，一些动物的一些图形。从这个上面我们可以看到他的大脑的两部分，逻辑的部分和艺术的部分的同时在运作。
One of Feynman's greatest legacies to physics is something called a Feynman diagram.Which is a way of representing fundamental properties in space and time in terms of these kinds of cartoons that show how the particles come to be and pass away as a function of time and move around in between. And different particles change into other particles.
费曼的一项非常杰出的贡献就是他所绘制的这个费曼图，在这个图当中他描述了时间和空间之间的一系列关系，以及粒子在这个过程当中所发挥的作用以及扮演的角色。我们可以看到他通过简单的这个图形，直观的一些线条和符号，也就是视觉化的图形，以及一些简单的方程式呢，来解释粒子是如何在时间空间这样两个维度当中呢不断的变化和作用这样的一个过程。
And although these look like simple cartoons, there are very definite rules for associating calculations with these pictures, and they give an accurate representation of what can happen and how to calculate it. I would say that together with the two other visualizations I showed you, Descartes' visualization of equations and Maxwell's visualization of Faraday's ideas, this is perhaps the third great visualization in physics.
这个图形看起来非常的简单，但其实呢，它是按照严格的一个方程式，或者说一个规律呢来运行的。所以在这些图形背后所包含的是非常严谨的数学和物理的概念。我把费曼图这样的一个图形和之前我所给大家看的笛卡尔的关于代数几何学的视觉化的一个图形，以及麦斯威尔对于法拉第的电磁场的这个图形呢，我把它们三个并称为是物理学当中视觉化的三次最为重要的应用。
So that, for instance, when physicists were trying to plan how to try to get evidence for the existence of something called a Higgs particle, which has been a central part of our theory of how interactions work for a long time but had never been observed, the first step was to draw some appropriate Feynman diagrams to find out what processes might be promising.
就比方说啊，我们要怎么样来验证我们所说的希格斯粒子，也就是我们所说的这个量子空间当中的这一系列的活动啊变化，它真的存在呢？我们怎么来证明这样的虚拟粒子真正的存在呢？首先，我们就要通过费曼图的这样的一些图形来进行一个推理和一个演绎，通过一些严格的一些原则呢来推断出希格斯粒子这样的虚拟粒子的存在。
And this particular one means a lot to me because one of the best contributions of the early part of my career was to realize this is a good way of making Higgs particles. That was in the late 1970s. It was only in 2012 that finally the experimentalists did this experiment and found the Higgs particle.
这个实验呢，对于我个人来说有着特别深远和重要的意义，因为我是在19世纪，在20世纪70年代的时候，当时我研究，我觉得就是可以通过这样的一个费曼图形，通过这些直线这些线条呢，可以来验证，希格斯粒子呢确实存在。但是事实上，一直要到2012年的时候呢，实验物理学家才真正的通过实验来证明了希格斯粒子确实存在。
And it really would have been very difficult or impossible to do that planning without this tool of visualization.
如果说没有这样的一个视觉化的一个手段作为辅助的话呢，是非常难通过一些数学方程式的概念呢来验证和推断希格斯粒子的存在的。And
now I'm just going to show a bunch of pictures because of the loss of time with all the translation. We're running behind schedule. So just some pictures that show scientific concepts and artistic themes that reflect them and sort of bring them into contact with our deepest sensibilities and experience of life. So light is a very important concept in physics, but it's also something we experience and something that can be made beautiful.
因为时间关系，我们这个讲座还要加上翻译的时间，所以说啊，我们现在已经有点延迟了。接下来呢，我就要给大家看一些图片。从这些图片当中，我们可以看到科学和艺术呢，其实在很多的层面呢，它是互相交织的。它们包含了很多共同的原则，很多最为深入的一些主题呢，是贯穿于科学和艺术之间的。一个例子，比方说。 光，我们知道，在科学当中，光，所有的科学研究都会把光作为一个非常重要的要素。但是光呢，同样它也是在艺术当中非常重要的一个元素。Warped
space is a concept that is central to Einstein's theory of how gravity works. According to Einstein, gravity is just particles moving in as straight a line as they can through a space that's warped by the presence of matter. That can be a difficult concept to visualize, and how images of outer space distorted by gravitational fields can be very difficult to visualize. But with the help of artists, we can start to relate to that and see its potentials.
扭曲的空间。扭曲的空间呢，在爱因斯坦关于重力的这个概念的这个解释当中，是一个非常重要的一个概念。在爱因斯坦看来呢，所谓重力呢，也就是粒子在通过一个扭曲的空间当中，因为物质的存在的影响啊，它所发生的一些作用。那么这样的一个抽象的概念呢，我们的大脑是很难用直观的方式去理解的。但是如果通过艺术家的手段把它描绘出来的话，我们就可以通过视觉化的这个感官这样的一个印象呢，来理解究竟什么样的一个空间呢，是我们科学家眼中的一个扭曲的空间。
I told you before about virtual particles and fluctuations that are happening all the time in space where energy moves around. That kind of vibrancy is somehow conveyed in this picture. Spontaneity.
之前我给大家解释了我所做的研究，也就是我的这个发现，就是说我们所谓的这些 空白的这些空间，其实到里面充满了能量的流动和粒子的相互作用。但是怎么来解释呢？从艺术的角度来说，也就是刚刚这个图片，它充满了一个自发的这样的一种生命力或者说活力。
That was a rather loose metaphor, but this one I really like because it's actually a very good metaphor, very close. In the state of matter called superconductivity, electrons all flow in a pattern that is very stable and can't be disrupted by heat or external fields. So electrons flow very smoothly, could flow forever in a superconductor. How can they do that when there are so many obstacles? Well, imagine trying to swim imagine being immersed in an ocean that's full of fish all moving in the same direction. Then it would be the easiest thing in the world to swim in the same direction. That's what superconductivity is. When all the electrons move in the same direction, it's very difficult for anyone to deviate.
还有就是这个流体这样的一个概念，这个科学和艺术之间的爱欲呢，可能会有一些需要我们来想一想才能够理解。我们说超导体，为什么说超导体它的导电性能这么的好呢？其实我们可以把这些电子啊，想象成我们大海当中的这个游泳的这个鱼。那么在什么情况下，这个电子可以永远的朝着一个方向有序的流动，而不会被干扰，也不会停止下来呢？就是因为就像这个大海当中所有的鱼呢，都是在向着同一个方向流动，所以在这样一个环境当中，你要再向这个方向流动，可以说是再容易不过了。你只要顺着这个鱼群一直往前游就可以了。所以说这样一来呢，就变得非常简单。而超导体里面的电子也是这样，它就是随着所有的电子一起流动，所以说它就有了超导的这样的一种性能。
So if the electrons get their act together and all cooperate, they can do great things. There's a lesson there.
所以说我们可以看到，如果这些电子他们可以齐心协力相互合作的话呢，就可以做出一些伟大的事情。从这个当中我们人类也可以学到很多。
One thing we learn in physics is that just looking at the externalities of things doesn't teach you how they actually work. That hidden structure is vital to understand and is a part of properly understanding anything. And this from the notebooks of Leonardo da Vinci is a wonderful example of hisfascination, and elucidation of inner structure.
物理学当中告诉我们一个非常重要的概念，就是说我们单看一件事情的外部呢，我们是没有办法了解它的内部结构究竟是怎么样的。很多的内部结构呢是潜在的、隐形的。那么这也可以从莱昂纳多·达芬奇他对于人体的解剖的这种绘图当中呢，找到一个很好的一个对照、一个呼应。因为达芬奇他非常热衷于人体解剖学，从这个人体的骨骼架构当中呢，来了解这个人体的这个美，它是来自于什么地方。
And now I'm just going to show you a few pictures with really minimal content, and let you use your imagination. Comment, I'm sorry, and let you use your imagination. So, sometimes by thinking about impossible things that.Nevertheless, or apparently impossible things that nevertheless are happening, we're led to deep insights.
接下来我给大家看几幅画，但是呢，我会尽量的不加评论，希望大家可以发挥自己的想象力。所以说，有的时候我们会发现，就比方说这儿，我们说其实最不可能发生的事情呢，有的时候就是在你的眼前发生了。
In fact, T.D. Lee's pondering of some things that seem to be impossible led him to.Proposed new laws of physics, which turned out to be correct.
我们可以看到 T.T. Lee 这个在这个画当中啊，他在想象着一些不可能的事情，但是这样的一个想象呢，却是真正的带来了一些物理学上的发现。
The union of opposites, the idea that yin and yang complement each other and neither could exist without the other, is directly reflected in the structure of quantum mechanics, where we have things like particles that behave like waves, waves that behave like particles, and more generally, what's called complementarity. So, union of opposites.
在太极当中有着阴和阳之间对立统一的这样一个概念，而这样的一个概念呢，在量子力学当中也得到了很好的一个呼应。我们说在量子力学当中，其实我们看到的粒子和波相互之间是可以互相转化的，而这个也很好的呼应了太极当中阴和阳的对立。
Sometimes our equations are very dangerous. They seem to lead to singularities or calculations of things that should be finite turn out to be infinite.That's very dangerous, and we change our theories to ward off danger.
有的时候，我们的一些方程式呢，它会带给我们一些比较带有危险的一些思考。有的时候，我们对于有限和无限的这种认识，我们认为是有限，但它却是无限的。但是无限的事物呢，又会有着一个有限的一个限制。这样的一种想法的时刻着提醒我们，其实风险呢是一直存在的。
And here's another example of exuberance combined with symmetry, but this time projected not into something large that's very, but into something small and becoming intricacy.
这一个又是关于对称和繁盛之间的一个两个概念的一个结合，由此所带来的一个错综和复杂，但是又非常精妙的这样一个设计。
Liberation, if I showed you how quarks would have a very difficult time getting through.All that activity that's going on in empty space, but if they have enough energy, they can just plow right through it. Quark liberation is a beautiful idea, closely connected to my Nobel Prize, and so I like that idea too.
如果说我能够用图像的方式来给大家呈现夸克粒子是怎么样获得解放或者自由，它能够自由地穿过我刚刚给大家看的这个能量空间的时候的话呢，我觉得刚刚这幅图是非常能够好的来解释夸克粒子的这种自由的释放的，而这个呢也是和我所获得的诺贝尔物理学奖有着非常紧密的联系。
And finally, the idea that we're immersed in an atmosphere that helps thatmakes things behave the way they do and kind of supports our activities that can support electric and magnetic fields. That's the mother of us all. I find this a very beautiful and appealing picture of how our atmosphere is our source of strength.
最后我想给大家看的这个就是我们常常会说环境或者说我们所处的这个氛围，这个环境对于我们能不能够做成一件事情其实有着一个很大的影响。在我看它就像一位母亲，她无所不在，但是呢同时她又不会会非常突兀，她只是在那里默默地支持我们，提供给我们养分和支持，这个就是我们所处的一个环境。我觉得这个呢是我想在最后给大家看的或者说表达的这样的一个概念。
And finally, I will end with a work of art by T.D. Lee, whose name has come up several times, the patron of our institute that's being whose ground is being broken today, a Shanghai native who really made good and made major contributions to physics and is still vibrant into his 90s. This is a picture aboutthe old paradox of chickens and eggs. Which came first, the chicken and the egg? And T.D. Lee's reaction is, let's hope that chickens and eggs keep going on forever and we never have to answer that question.
最后呢，我想用李政道先生的一幅画来结束我今天的讲座。大家知道，李政道研究中心呢也是我们今天这个讲座的主办方。李政道先生本人，他在90高龄的时候仍然是致力于科学研究。 今天呢，稍后的时候，李政道研究中心呢也会在上海的科学城破土动工。所以说，我想用他的一幅画来结束今天的讲座。这是他所画的一幅关于究竟先有鸡还是先有蛋的这个经典的问题的一个回答。我觉得他本人的回答也非常的机智，同时也是富有非常深刻的意义。他说啊，只要我们就希望吧，希望永远有鸡，也永远有蛋，这样呢，我们就不需要来回答这个头疼的问题了。谢谢大家。
So, one more sentence. So it's a charming work of art, a charming thought, and a very convincing demonstration that some of the greatest scientists also have an artistic sensibility, and that's no accident.
最后我想再说一句，我觉得这是一幅非常好的绘画的艺术作品，它又再一次验证了我所说的一个观点，其实在很多的科学家在他们的脑海当中呢，都是有着一个艺术的灵感，艺术呢始终是科学研究当中密不可分的一部分。
Thank you.
谢谢。
非常感谢 Wilczek 教授给我们精彩的讲座。